Okay, good evening, everyone. Hello. My name is Stephanie Strain, and I am Curator of Exhibitions and Projects here at Modern Art Oxford. Thank you so much for joining us here this evening. Welcome to the gallery and to this evening's talk, which forms part of our public programme of events dedicated to our current exhibition, Lubaina Himid, Invisible Strategies. We're thrilled to welcome to Oxford Dr. Dorothy Price, a reader in the history of art at the University of Bristol. Dr. Price is an art historian with particular research interests in sexuality, race, gender, women artists, photography, modernism, and contemporary art. She has fostered a long-standing dialogue with Lubaina Himid and her practice across many years. And her talk tonight will range across several different bodies of work that we have on show in the exhibition upstairs, including the revenge paintings from 1991 to 1992 and the more recent Kanga works on paper series. Dr. Price is both an art historian and a curator, working across German and British art of the 20th and 21st centuries. From July of this year, she will assume the role of the editor of Art History, a world-leading journal published by Wiley-Blackwell for the Association of Art Historians. She's also one of the curators of a major new exhibition, Expressionism, Rebirth and Renewal, opening at the Royal Academy of Arts in London in spring 2019. This will be the first large-scale exhibition of German and Austrian Expressionism in the UK for over 30 years, and an unparalleled opportunity to set new research agendas in the field. Dr. Price is also a member of the Academic Advisory Board of the Royal Academy, the Royal West of England Academy, and a reviewer for the American Academy in Berlin. She's in the planning stages of curating and co-curating two forthcoming exhibitions at the Royal West of England Academy, In Plain Sight, British Art Since 1950, and Women, Collage, and Pop. Dorothy is also at work on several new publications, including two new monographs, New Women, New Vision, Icons of Modernity in Weimar, Germany, and Kathy Colvitz, Between Symbolism and Expressionism, as well as several edited collaborations and collections, including German Expressionism, Der Blaue Reiter and Its Legacies, Framing the Critical Decade After the Black Arts Movement, and Weimar's Others, Art History and Visual Culture in Germany After 1918, which is a special issue of Art History coming out in April 2018. These are just her forthcoming titles. She's obviously published numerous books and articles in the field previous to this, but I'm not going to read them out because we'd be here all night and she has to give her talk. But it ranges across her research interests in Black, Asian, and diasporic art in Britain, German Expressionism, and Weimar culture. Finally, Dorothy also acts as a trustee at Spike Island, which is one of our touring partners and collaborators for this exhibition project, where there is a concurrent solo exhibition of Lubaina's work entitled Navigation Charts. And this show is on until the end of March, and if you're in Bristol or able to get there, I'd really encourage you to visit it. Please join me in welcoming Dorothy to Modern Art Oxford for her talk.
Thank you very much, Stephanie, and I'd like to kind of extend my thanks to Stephanie and to Emma and to Sarah and to Jonathan and all the team at Modern Oxford for inviting me here tonight, and also to all of you for turning out on a Thursday evening to hear my talk as well. So thank you all very much. So as Stephanie's indicated, I've enjoyed a long-term engagement with Lubaina's work over many decades, and I'm feeling a bit old now after that introduction. But I also have, you know, with that engagement, I've also been lucky enough to acquire a few pieces of her work along the way, and I brought two of the smaller ones with me tonight because I thought you might be interested in them, particularly because one of the pieces is a preparatory sketch for this plate here from the Lancaster Dinner Service, Swallow Hard, which is on display upstairs. And the other one is a kind of reminiscent. It's a photograph come sort of montage that's reminiscent of this very early poster of an early exhibition of Lubaina's work from 1986 called A Fashionable Marriage. And it speaks to the work I've brought with me, as well as some things I'm going to talk about tonight, speaks to an intertwined relationship between photography and painting that characterises a lot of Lubaina's practice, which I want to talk about a little bit more. And so the two works are on the table at the end, so feel free at the end to come and have a quick look at them. So the intertwined relationship between photography and painting in Lubaina's practice can be seen right across her work, from its early beginnings with the bitingly satirical A Fashionable Marriage, of which these two are installation shots. A Fashionable Marriage was originally made in 1986, and it was remade for Tate Liverpool in 2014. And so this kind of relationship between photography and painting starts kind of quite early on, and it carries on right up to the present in Lubaina's most recent series of painted Kangas with their wonderfully quirky collaged owners, which I want to talk about a little bit towards the end of my talk as well. And this is one of these Kangas, Never Sleep Inside the Invisible, with its owner next to it. And these were made in 2016. But what then is the invisible in Himid's work, and how can we navigate it? In a 2013 interview conducted with the art historian Jane Beckett, Lubaina explained that the aim of her work, quote, has always been to engage in dialogue with the audience, to exchange and build on ideas about the ways we could collaborate in a lifelong project to make the invisible threads of certain historical narratives part of an everyday conversation. The emphasis is more on the feelings and memories, learned behaviours and tiny habits as experienced from the inside, which then go on to inform future small personal actions. So as a participatory audience then, we're admonished never to sleep inside the invisible, but rather where we find it, to retrieve it, and where we can, however big or small, to act on it for freedom and change. Indeed, the artwork Freedom and Change, on view again in the galleries upstairs, brings me to another of Lubaina's strategies, one that permeates her practice from the outset, namely her engagement with visual histories of modernism, and specifically what might be at stake for Lubaina in those engagements with art history's troubled modernist past. Whilst A Fashionable Marriage borrowed the bitingly satirical mantle of Hogarth, Rawlinson, Gilray, etc., and other satirists from the 18th and 19th centuries, and updated it for the 20th century, Freedom and Change announced a head-on engagement with high modernism in no uncertain terms. The monumental abandon of Picasso's décolleté racing women, this painting here, engaged in a timeless escapism from the troubled landscape of post-First World War Europe, is reconfigured by Himid into a confrontation with the limits of 1980s political culture. Indeed, in a recent interview in the art newspaper, these kind of issues are highlighted. The interviewer says, "It's deeply depressing that so many of the issues you're raising years ago have become so ominously topical." Lubaina responds, "Of course, I could not have believed that all these years later, instead of Margaret Thatcher, we would have Theresa May, and instead of Ronald Reagan, we'd have Donald Trump. In the intervening years, all of us from every angle thought we'd dealt with things, but it turns out that we only dealt with things in a surface way. We thought, that's okay, there are black people in the newspapers now, or we can see black people on the television, or everyone's acknowledging that we have made this or that kind of progress. But we never went as far as we could go, or to the very core of what we could achieve. We left things half-baked. We just scratched the surface and this went on to something else, and now it's all come back to bite us." So the interviewer continues, "So how do you feel about your work being revisited within today's political culture?" Lubaina, "I've never felt so exposed. We were dealing with an invisibility, trying to get ourselves seen, trying to get ourselves shown, trying to make the point about being part of the history and contributing to the wealth of the nation. I hope that younger artists will find this work useful, if only in order to see the mistakes we made. But I think artists today are more able to understand strategy and to deal with their visibility and the complex place that they find themselves in." As a painter who trained initially as a theatre designer, the visual impact of monumental stage design on its audience was something that Lubaina remained alert to from the outset. So Freedom and Change is a direct allusion not just to a painting by Picasso, but more specifically to Picasso's design for a monumental theatre curtain for the one-act ballet, Le Train Bleu, choreographed by Nijinska for the Ballet Russe in Paris in 1924. If Lubaina wished to retrieve the invisible threads of the historical presence of black people in Europe, and black women in particular, then what better way than to strategize with the tools of dramatic performance in which she'd initially been trained? And you can see just how monumental the original curtain for Le Train Bleu is. The explicit role of theatre, combined with the interrogation of painterly modernism, first explored in Freedom and Change, becomes a more subtle riff in Lubaina's magisterial series of paintings produced in 1991 and then first exhibited in 1992. Revenge, a mask in five tableaux, consists of nine large paintings, 16 smaller studies, an installation, and accompanying elegiac texts that form the tableau of the title. And it's interesting that she works in a series of nine. Then I'm not showing all nine here. I've got eight of them here, and then one small of the studies. And it's so some of the works from Revenge are also on display upstairs, but not the whole series. And it's a very large series. And it's also quite a flexible series as well, I think. Lubaina has said she often works in series of nine, and she says she's not quite sure why, but it seems to be a kind of a sort of number that she is at home with when she's constructing a sort of narrative series as well. And it's clearly a motif that runs throughout. So her series of Kangas are always in series of nine as well, and the Kangas are quite recent works, whereas this is from 1990s. So this is something a kind of consistent part of her practice. The narrative arc of Revenge follows the poetic histories of two black women through the passage of time from Africa to Europe. Read collectively, the paintings, studies, installation, and writings offer a powerful set of propositions for black women's present, future, and continuing agency in the post-colonial West, set against the legacies of the violent colonial pasts of their enslaved African ancestors, and engaged in an active dialogue with European art histories. Paintings and scripts constitute the warp and the woof of a rich historical tapestry in which sails, robes, cloths, highly coloured fabrics, tents, canopies, flags, patterns, rugs, and textiles operate literally and metaphorically to activate multiple meanings from within the formal structures of the objects and the texts. And this focus on African textiles in particular, again, a very early strategy in Lubaina's work, very early with kind of installations like New Robes from Mashulan, which was an early installation, through to the kind of painterly rendition of textiles in the Revenge series, through to, again, the emulation of the Kangas, West African textiles that are worn by women. It's a constant motif. And again, I think it's biographical as well. Her mother was a textile designer. So I think there is a kind of constant sort of certain visual motifs that remain within her practice. So this is just, as I said, an overview of some of the works from the Revenge series, and I just want to focus in on a few of them now. Tableau 1 of Revenge and the corresponding painting Carpet stages the complexity of the mask, and that's important that Revenge is a mask, as in a theatrical mask. So stages the complexity of the mask in visual dialogue with the modernist abstraction of Matisse's cutouts. Visual allusions to the blocks of vibrant colour deployed in Matisse's Snail of 1953 are recalled. Yet as in Matisse's work, pure abstraction is resisted. Jill Morgan has commented that the black women in Revenge sit upon multicoloured overlaid rugs to discuss strategy in their abstract form. The abstract forms in Carpet are figured oppositionally as black and white, symbolic of the entwined colonial histories of Africa and Europe that are being interrogated in the series. The vibrant red, yellow, pink, green, orange, and blue palette of carpet is repeated in the rhythm of colours across the series as a whole, suggesting that colour and form are deliberately deployed to belie the impulse to read these canvases either chronologically or monologically. Rather, a conception of synchronic dialogical time is structured through Himid's formal choices as a painter. And what's interesting about the series, when you read it in conjunction with the texts that go with it, is that the texts condense the painting, so you can't sort of plot individual paintings against individual texts, but it's a narrative arc and it's a cyclical one as well. So there isn't a, and I, you know, I've sort of written about this series quite a lot, and I sort of tried to sort of plot its order, but its order gets disrupted all the time, and I don't think it's really meant to be read necessarily in a sort of easily linear way. I think, and I think that's a deliberate strategy as well. I think it's, they're interchangeable moments in the series as well. Which I'll talk about a little bit more. A project to memorialise the horrors of the Middle Passage is alluded to in the texts of tableaus 3 and 4 and their corresponding artworks. Memorial to Zong, 6 studies for a fountain and 10 studies for a monument. This is conceptualised as part of a political imperative for a different set of future relationships between Africa and Europe, in which black women will be the agents for remembering, interrupting and changing the course of events. Himid comments, quote, that their language is more akin to the call of the birds or the growth and blossoming of flowers. Indeed, such evocations of temporally recurring cycles are redolent of French philosopher Julia Kristeva's reconceptualization of women's time as both monumental and cyclical, in opposition to the linear and masculine time of history and language, in which women are positioned in a relation of sacrifice and enslavement. Whilst remaining alert to individual differences between women, Kristeva asks the pertinent question, how can we reveal our place, first as it is bequeathed to us by tradition, and then as we want to transform it? Likewise, Revenge asks comparable questions with artworks that pertain to the past, present, and future roles for black women as subjects within Western histories. In tableau 1, patterns, colours, cloth flapping, beating in the wind, robes wrapped against the sun and the cold of the night, fabric highly coloured, woven, sewn together, umbrellas, tent canopies, flags, banners. The patterns on the cloths hold the clues to events. As the mask progresses, this visually rich semiotic field constitutes a signifying system in which the relationships between signs are structured both aesthetically and politically, binding the 5 tableaux and the corresponding paintings together in an evocative and active cycle of memory and change. By tableau 5, the abstract forms that have been transfigured into 2 black women who are cast in multiple dialogic roles as necessary agents for historical revolution, set against the legacies of the traumatic histories of invasion, slavery, colonization, and murder that have been alluded to in the preceding tableau. So if you like, it starts with these kind of abstract forms here. It sort of moves again. It abstracts the idea of an invasion and a kind of an African reference to histories of African slavery through the Mansour of Mali, a particular historical moment, through to invasion, where you still have these kind of abstracted forms. And then a kind of palingenesis occurs, which I'll talk about in a little bit moment. And then the abstraction kind of becomes reconfigured into these kind of figurative canvases that sort of finish the circle and then come back to the beginning again, which I'll talk about a little bit. The references to the painterly modernism of Matisse in Carpet are part of a wider network of allusions to the aesthetic practices of many other avant-garde artists within the Revenge series, including Turner, Mary Cassatt, James Tissot, Gertrude Stein, and Pablo Picasso. Like Matisse, Picasso was enthralled by the radical difference he perceived in the formal properties of African sculpture that he had imported into, that had been imported into France during colonial rule since the late 19th century. Modernity's economic and aesthetic dependence on plunder from Africa is central to Himid's painterly reworking of colonial pasts. Yet as well as references to modernism, the literary structure of dramaturgy, suggested by the concept of the mask, revenge as a mask in five tableaux, also activates other layers of signification. Within English literary tradition, one of the most well-known authors of courtly masks was 17th century Jacobean dramatist Ben Jonson. Whilst a variety of mask traditions can also be found in Africa, and in both Western and African traditions, masks were enacted through allegorical and mythological references rather than via chronological narratives. In thinking about Himid's work, this dual tradition of allegorical signification is particularly resonant, since a central tenet of her work involves answering back to Western cultural forms, interrupting them and steering another course. In both English and Yoruban mask traditions, the masquerader's main function was a patrilineal one designed to entertain the king and confirm his status as a monarch. However, scholars have observed that between 1604 and 1609, English Jacobean court masks somewhat unusually staged the bodies and the intentions of the Queen. In 1603, King James I had ascended to the throne of England with his wife, Queen Anne of Denmark. According to several commentators, Anne held a marginal, liminal position at court, representing power once removed. It was only through the commissioning of and acting in a specific series of masks that Anne was able to perform a set of disruptions and displacements of male power through dramatic fiction on stage via the racialized body of feminine excess, in counterpoint to a Jacobean norm. Three of the five masks that Anne commissioned, the Mask of Blackness in 1605, the Mask of Beauty in 1608, and the Mask of Queens in 1609, were a trio written by Ben Jonson and designed by Inigo Jones. And these are just some of Inigo Jones, two of Inigo Jones' designs for those masks. These are both from the Mask of Blackness. The plot of the Mask of Blackness developed from Queen Anne's request to perform herself and her attendants disguised as Africans using black body paint instead of the usual deployment of masks. Whilst Jonson's Mask of Blackness deploys the bodies of blacked-up white women to probe the boundaries of the patriarchal order within the British Jacobean court, Himid's Revenge recuperates the visualisation of black women's bodies as signifiers for a whole new system of visual representation within British arts histories. She gets inside the invisible, yanks it from its origins, and reconfigures it. As such, Revenge is not a mask in the tradition of a celebration of imperial expansion, monarchic authority, or aristocratic hierarchy, as in the Renaissance mask traditions of Ben Jonson and Inigo Jones, but rather it's a lamentation, a monument to the survival of African people and the transformations of African culture. And I think this is what's really interesting about what Himid does, is that she looks at different forms, she looks at past forms, visual and aesthetic forms, theatrical forms, painterly forms, and she reconfigures them and recuperates the possibilities within them and completely turns them on their head and sort of reinserts a possibility for black female subjectivity, and I think it's, you know, there's a very deliberate dialogue with past representations of blackness and aesthetic blackness as well. Whilst Tableau 1 and 2 set the scene of the mask, its mercurial heart is exposed in the texts and accompanying images for Tableaus 3 and 4. Memorial to Zong and 10 Studies for a Monument comprise a poignant visual eulogy to the lost lives of the people enslaved from West Africa in 1781 and then murdered by being thrown overboard the British slave ship Zong. Whilst the practice of slave owning was endemic to all imperial civilizations, ranging from ancient Greece and Rome, 4th century Ghana, 14th century Mali and beyond, the particular flashpoint here is that African slavery was still deemed a legitimate practice in late 18th century Europe, during the same era in which the economic, social, and epistemological foundations of our own era were first established with the so-called Enlightenment. And this is a replica of the Zong, the ship, the Zong. The Zong was a ship from Liverpool that had taken on more slaves than it could safely transport in its journey from Africa to Jamaica. After 2 months at sea, overcrowding, malnutrition, and disease had killed 7 of the 17 crew members and 60 of the 440 slaves on board. The captain decided to throw the remaining 132 sick slaves, sick, not dying, overboard in order to claim the £30 insurance money per slave, which you could legally claim as lost cargo. When the Zong massacre became publicly known, in part because Oluwadu Equiano had brought it to the attention of abolitionist campaigners, it became a buttress in the subsequent battles for the abolition of the slave trade. That was just a picture of Oliano's memoirs. And I don't know if any of you saw the recent BBC One drama, Taboo, but there was a similar plot line, I think, going on between the East India Company and a slave ship, and I think it was sort of borrowed from this particular narrative. When Lubaina Himid began painting the works for revenge in 1991, there was very little widespread public knowledge, understanding, information or remembrance of the Zong and its legacies in Britain. Paul Gilroy was amongst the first of those few commentators who did raise it publicly in an important essay for The New Statesman that he published in 1990. Writing about the existence of aesthetic representation of black suffering in the 19th century as part of a riposte to a famous exhibition now put on by Rashid Areen called The Other Story at the Hayward Gallery, where Rashid Areen had attempted to show the kind of active presence of black artists in Britain since the 1950s, and he'd called it The Other Story, so it was a kind of an alternative history of British art since the Second World War. And Gilroy kind of took issue with the premise of Areen's exhibition, and he commented that, quote, these images... So he's commenting very specifically about the aesthetic representation of black suffering in the 19th century, and he says, these images were not an alien or a natural presence that had somehow intruded into English life from the outside. They were an integral means with which England was able to make sense of itself and its destiny. The picture in its strange history, talking about Turner's Slavers, this particular painting, the picture in its strange history posed a challenge to the black English today. It demands that we strive to integrate the different dimensions of our hybrid cultural heritage more effectively. In doing this, we may discover that our story is not the other story after all, but the story of England in the modern world. Subsequent accounts of the Zong massacre, such as Ian Bocum's 2007 Spectres of the Atlantic, situate the event of the Zong massacre in Ernst Bloch's terms as non-contemporaneously contemporary, as not simply an act of past violence, but an event that encapsulates a wider capitalist logic only recently perfected in the present. Fred Daguerre's 1999 novel, Feeding the Ghosts, was an imaginative attempt to rewrite the tragedy of Zong for contemporary readers through the traumatic fictional story of one black woman's survival of the incident. And Turner's Slavers was painted long after the incident as a sort of history painting, and it had a kind of a very ambivalent reception at the time of its exhibition. To do with some people just avoided the subject matter altogether and just focused on the kind of formal aesthetic properties of the work. Others kind of honed in on the subject matter and felt that the work was too much of a reminder of kind of slavery's past, and others kind of celebrated the picture as a kind of demonstrating how far British culture had moved on. So it had a very contentious history, this painting. (Clears throat) Although not necessarily directly inspired by Turner's painting, Frederick Weir's choice of a female heroine in his novel Feeding the Ghosts could be seen as an act of metaphorical recuperation of the disembodied leg that is being devoured by fish here in Turner's Slavers. This is just the kind of bottom corner of the painting. Many commentators identify the leg as belonging to a woman, presumably because of the delicacy of the surviving foot here. But there are very few other visual clues to sort of identify the gender, really. Yet, as Andrew Oppitz has commented, remembering Atlantic slavery is not about political correctness or about exorcising ghosts from the past. It's about salvaging a livable future from the soiled wreckage of history. In 1991, Lubaina had already begun wrestling with these particular challenges for a number of years in her activities as a painter, writer, and curator, seeking strategies for getting inside the invisible. In Memorial to Zong, the invisible of the African body is forever lost to the waters of the Middle Passage. As she commented over a decade later, "I'm interested in the politics of representation and how when something is there, you talk about it, or you think about it, or you write about it. But when something isn't there, what do you say? How can you make something of that? How can it not have been in vain?" So that idea of memorialising really came from trying to visibilise the invisible. In study from Memorial to Zong, the duality of water as a potent agent of either destruction or salvation at sea is evoked in a beautifully economical sketch in which a single brown hand emerges from a deep blue ocean. The hand holds up its five fingers, and whilst we know that within the context of Zong, it's not waving but drowning, the visual economy of the work, its art historical differencing of Turner's iconography and Slavers, its symbolic link to one of the final revenge paintings called Five, also upstairs, and Himid's overall Benjaminian philosophy of history, the retrieving the future from the wreckage of the past, all point to its exceeding a purely memorialising function in favour of a more fluid, dynamic, dialogical and non-linear relational poetics. Himid shifts the visual focus from Turner's disembodied leg to the smaller, more frequently overlooked area of the chained hands. I'll just go back a minute. So over here there's kind of also chained hands. So this is where the leg is. There's also chained hands going on over here. In a form of visual palingenesis, Himid releases a single drowning hand from its chains, unhooking one of the standard tropes of European art historical representation that depicts black people as either slaves or servants. Himid's hand is central and clear. It's not overwhelmed by the forces of sublime nature, as in the Turner. And within the vocabulary of her iconography and revenge, it signifies dialectically. In Five, one of the final paintings of the series, the resituated hand is no longer drowning in a deep blue ocean, but instead emerges against a vibrant yellow ground, the colour of Africa, as in previous tableau. The hand now belongs to an animated black woman. The jug and bowl from earlier works are also refigured as accoutrements on a Parisian cafe table. A modernist still life rendered in the style of Vanessa Bell. Yet the presence of the bowl continues to signify the absence of the African people who were lost to the horrors of the Middle Passage, the savage foundations of European and American modernity. The bowl is placed between two plates bearing maps, Africa on the right, America on the left, the bowl in the centre, the jug positioned to the viewer's side. According to Himid, the flowers in the vase are Egyptian, further embedding the fabric of Africa into this contested and repossessed space. The figure on the right, who borrows Gertrude Stein's coat, suggests that the mantle is being passed from avant-garde outsider, a Jewish lesbian, the mother of modernism, to women who will, as radically as she, realign culture through what they make. Griselda Pollock has considered Five in some detail. noting that the space is not closed off to the viewer, others may pull up a chair. By multiplying their presence, Himid resolutely refuses to let her two black women carry the burden of representation for all black women. In a deliberate countermove to the prevailing monological economy identified in Sonia Boyce's sardonic observation in 1992, that if you're a black woman in the art world, one is enough. As Himid also explains, the theme of rewriting history is at the centre of all the work in the series, but it also refers to the reality of my sharing a project to change the world with other black women, and understanding that this can only succeed if we agree that there are many different ways to do this. In all the revenge paintings, we are arguing. In our house, we are arguing. Don't worry about the text too much, I'll come back to that in a moment. Tableau 5, the last act, conjures a myriad of symbolic threads around its own end that paradoxically leads us back to the beginnings, a labyrinthine circle of Christavan time. The number 5 is multiply deployed, layering in on itself repeatedly, rocking our visual memories back and forth from the five-fingered hand of the study for Zong to the 5 scenarios for 2 women imagined in the text of Tableau 5 to one of the final correspondings 5, and perhaps not insignificantly, to the recall of Himid's very first group exhibition entitled 5 Black Women, which showed work by Sonia Boyce, Lubaina Himid, Claudette Johnson, Huria Nati, and Veronica Ryan, which was held at London's Africa Centre in 1983. Himid's professional beginnings as both artist and curator in the 5 Black Women show fostered expanded networks of collaboration between black and Asian women artists that were to continue throughout the 1980s and well into the 1990s and beyond. Tableau 5 in Revenge continues that project. 2 women standing ankle deep behind banners in front of cloths, shredding maps, fragments float away. 2 women sit in a small boat tearing up navigation charts. How many died crossing the water? 2 women sit there in a theatre box ripping up maps. Can the past be replayed? 2 women sit at dinner forming a strategy. Can the future be different, better? 2 women sit on rugs, reliving history and planning the future. Magic carpet fly. Ankle Deep inaugurates the next phase of palingenesis or rebirth. In Ankle Deep, the ocean waves crash onto the shores of a new era, bearing with them 2 black women seeking their revenge from the fabric of history. The women shred and scatter the colonial maps of the past before searching new robes and debating new directions. In between the two, my heart is balanced. The Ankle Deep women, dramatis personae, inhabited by Maud Salter and Lubaina Himid, have donned richly coloured, deeply woven robes adapted from the wardrobes of Tissot's Portsmouth Dockyard of 1877, but transformed into the fabric of African textiles. The women navigate their small boat and continue to shred their charts until water and maps are finally left behind and a new narrative can begin. Act 1, No Maps, sees our heroines ousting Renoir, Cassatt and Morisot from their loges and gazing at the empty stage before them, waiting perhaps for a new post-revenge mask to unfold. Salter and Himid hijack the spaces of masculine urban modernity and whilst also nodding in the direction of their white female predecessors, temporarily but necessarily eject them to place themselves in the frame. The project of engaging with invisible threads of racialized identities within modernism, of challenging and subverting them by inserting visible narratives for multiple black women, is one that Himid continues to engage with. Her series of Kanga works, Kangas from the Lost Sample Book, made for the Whitworth's 2011 exhibition, Cotton Global Threads, and her most recent series of 9 Walter Benjamin Kangas made in 2016 are a compelling combination of exquisitely painted canvases, which are each accompanied by a different collaged female owner. And I wanted to put up the multiplicity of these owners just to kind of, in a sense, kind of continue the point about this idea of kind of Himid's strategy of making spaces for a representation of black women, but also a kind of reinsertion of them into histories as well. And this is one of the Kangas safety, safety is the lost territory with one of its owners. Kangas from the Lost Sample Book originated from Lubaina's overall philosophy of working with museums, which is to find the thing in the collection that doesn't always get shown, and then to use it as a starting point for new work, making the invisible visible, and to make a presence out of fragments. And this is something you can also see in her installation Naming the Money, which is currently on display in Bristol at Spike Island, which was originally made for the Hatton Gallery in Newcastle. And on the back of each of the figures in Naming the Money, there's a little piece of cloth and textile and a sort of museum inventory, a fictitious museum inventory of each of the figures. The Whitworth, for the Cotton Global Threads show, the Whitworth had a small collection of West African Kangas, which are decorated rectangular cloths, usually bearing a slogan of some kind and worn by women. And this was her starting point. The idea of the lost sample book stemmed from the decline of Manchester's textile industry and the likely disposal of its trappings, including the many hundreds of sample books containing patterns and designs now lost. The slogans on Lubaina's Kangas are deliberately edgy, indicative, as she says, not of a dangerous existence, but of a fragile one. They are, quote, about how to keep going, how to survive, how to carry on, and about how to understand the change of life, its pitfalls and its dangers. After she'd finished them, she realised that they needed to belong to someone, especially if she were going to engage audiences and start new conversations. She says, I wanted to take them from being from the lost sample book to a state of belonging. Again, from the invisible to the visible. And when my father bought Kangas for his mother and her friends to go to a wedding, they all had the same pattern. They went as a group. And I just wanted to show you quickly each of the individual figures. So these are each of the owners. Because the owners are very, although they're much smaller than the Kangas themselves, they're very much part of a pair. They're not, you know, they're not alone. They're very much kind of sort of in dialogue with one another, which kind of comes back to this idea of this dialogue that Lubaina often has between photography and painting in her work, I think. And these are just each of the owners. That's where I finish. Okay. So each Kanga has an owner then. A woman who might have owned the piece and who now displays it as hers. And that's the other thing about the ownership, that it's kind of a belonging, if you like. And each woman is a collage, sourced from lots of different magazines, chopped up, and as Lubaina has commented in an interview, made into, quote, new women. The concept of collage new women immediately recalls the Dada photo montages of Hannah Hoch, such as Dar Dandy of 1919. And this is just one example of Hannah Hoch's New Women. As well as the more immediate precursor of Maud Salter's arresting and enigmatic photo montage series, Circus, of 1993. And this is an example from Circus, and this is an example from one of the kind of springboards that generated Circus for Maud Salter. It's a photograph by August Sander, a German photographer from the 20s and 30s. One of Maud's most complex series of works, layered and supported with her poem Blood Money, Circus was inspired by photographs of black circus workers taken by 1920s German photographer August Sander and spoke to the complex horrors of the histories of black people in Germany before, during and after the Holocaust. Another key link in the formal visual chain between Hoch and Sander in 1920s Germany and Maud Salter in 1990s London and Scotland, can also be found in the art of Romare Bearden, particularly his wonderful Conjure Woman here, a source of all hope who is called upon repeatedly in Bearden's work, quote, to prepare love potions, cure illnesses, and assist with personal problems. In Bearden's words, it was my search for better ways of getting a social message into my cartoons which led me to the works of Daumier, Ferrin and Käthe Kollwitz, to the Art Students League and to George Gross. What impressed and challenged me most were the corrosive line drawings and the watercolours of Gross, the drawings of Gross on the theme of the human situation in post-World War I Germany made me realise the artistic possibilities of black American subject matter. It was also Gross who led me to study composition. Everything I've done since then has been, in effect, an extension of my experiments with flat painting, shallow space, Byzantine stylization, and African design. Bearden's work suggests a clear lineage then from the German Dadaists, George Gross was a member of Berlin Dada, together with Hannah Hoch, to contemporary black British art via Maud Salter, which serves to further underline Lubaina's arguments with and reinventions of the invisible racialized threads entangled in visual modernism. Lubaina's work continues to open up a realm of possibilities with the most economical of means. As Romy Smith has commented, Lubaina's works are like a series of rooms or stanzas. Thought about poetically, they evoke Gavin Yanti's ideas about poetic language as a goal in his own work. In particular, Yanti's focus on, quote, the economy of language that the poetic demands, something that's also well understood by Maud Salter. I would also suggest that collage as a medium enables a similar economy of means within visual language. So it's about this kind of getting to the heart of something very directly, through a kind of simplicity almost. The careful cutting out and restitching together of multiple visual sources, ideas, and discourses that rearrange the accepted order of things is a perfect formal strategy for excavating the invisible and revisibilizing it. It's a violent opening up of existing narratives and a suturing of them back together in new and unexpected ways. It's also a brilliant medium for satire. It allows one to play with scale and to juxtapose seemingly incongruous images in order to create unexpected outcomes. It embraces fragmentation and multiplicity and is also inherently democratic. Linguistically, montage is linked to mass production. Montieren in German means to assemble or to fit. A monteur is an engineer. And it's what the Berlin Dadaists refer to themselves as. So as well as the transnational pictorial lineage from Hoch, Gross and Sander to Romare Bearden, Kangas, such as Shelter in the Shade of Deep Friendship, not only evoke an academic past in tribute to Maud Salter's similar deployment of montage over old master paintings in some of the works in Circus, but they also present a new set of interpretive possibilities. In this work by Lubaina, the owner of the Kanga has been carefully montaged onto Delacroix's portrait of the landscape painter Louis-Auguste Schwitter, over here. Schwitter's portrait was painted after Delacroix's return from London to Paris in 1826. Delacroix entered the painting into the Salon of 1827, alongside his magisterial Death of Sardanapalus, a quintessential work of Romanticism. The Sardanapalus was accepted by the Salon, but the portrait of Schwitter was not. The Salon was obviously looking for something more extravagant in its Romantic painters that year. But nevertheless, Schwitter still remains an essay in Romanticism, a portrait of an aesthete and a dandy, a dandy perhaps, in sublime landscape, and one clearly admired by Degas, who subsequently bought it. But more interestingly, what I particularly liked about this choice of artist by Lubaina, conscious or otherwise, was Baudelaire's description of Delacroix as a painter of, quote, the invisible, the impalpable, of reverie, the nerves, the soul. And this he did without any means other than contour and colour. And this is a description, I contend, that Baudelaire could as easily have written for Lubaina. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dorothy, for such a stimulating weaving together of many of the works that we see upstairs and some of their partners which aren't here, just to show the kind of wider body of Lubaina's work, which is just so in depth and so rich, and to sort of tease out some of those iconographic threads for us. We have some time for a few questions. If anybody from the audience would like to ask Dorothy, I would ask you wait for me to disentangle the microphone and bring that to you, because we're recording the talk for posterity. So give me a second. So I'm really interested in, obviously, the parts of your talk that bring together your two art historical disciplines, the early 20th century German art, and Lubaina's work in the context of contemporary British arts. And I wonder if I could probe you a bit on this choice of adjective or description where you're referring to the violence of collage and of cutting and of, you know, both incising and then suturing together. Because for me, when I think of Hannah Hook's practice, it's obviously a time of great political and social unrest and upheaval in Germany. And a lot of her works make direct reference to politicians and to figures in contemporary life. And I wonder if you can talk a bit more about that idea of violence, referring to a kind of social context.
Yeah, that's really good question, interesting question. Yeah, I think that, so when Hannah Hoch and the Berlin Dada, so for example, when let's put Dada Dandy up. So when Dada Dandy was made in 1919, as part of kind of Dada's sort of revolutionary impulse after the First World War, Germany just kind of literally was just emerging from a really bitter civil war, which was a tussle for political power, which included kind of, you know, assassination of political figures, heroes of the left, for example. And Dada was very much, Berlin Dada in particular, it was very, so the various different manifestations of Dada across Europe and America, they all had different edges. And in Berlin Dada was probably the, well, was the most politically edgy and the most kind of radical in those political terms. And so I think photomontage was a really good way of very quickly getting to the heart of the messages that a lot of the Berlin Dadaists wanted to convey. And one of the things they were really good at, this isn't a particularly good example of that kind of political sort of sense of sort of violence, if you like, but one of the things they were really good at probing were and sort of satirizing were the sort of propaganda photographs of the various politicians of the day. So after the First World War, when the Kaiser had to abdicate, the sort of the liberal kind of middle politicians and politicians on the right went into an uneasy coalition to stop communism, and so this uneasy coalition meant that the whole of the Weimar Republic, the whole of the 20s in Germany, was politically compromised, if you like, and the Dadaists, who were sympathetic to the communist cause, wasted no time in sort of satirizing those political compromises, making fun at, poking fun at President Ebert, the kind of new president of the Weimar Republic. And I think that, you know, the technique of making these montages, as well as the kind of disruption of the political order, if you like, in photomontage, it's also a formal strategy as well. You know, she's using a scalpel to make these works. She's they're very, you know, this, as I say, if we I hadn't got the other cut with a kitchen knife, which is what I guess you're referring to, which is quite a small piece, and it's very, very detailed. It's very dense collage. Tiny little heads of politicians are kind of put on bodies of Dadaists or bodies of dancers or whatever it might be. And so to make those montages, she had to use a scalpel. So there's a kind of incision, kind of a formal sort of, you know, kind of really excising, I think. And you can just kind of imagine her pleasure in that kind of in those incisions of cutting out those heads and repurposing them, I think. Yeah, but interesting question. Thank you. Yes. Hi.
Thank you. That was fascinating. I'm not an art historian or artist, but very interested in East Africa. So I'm wondering if I could ask a background question about Lubaina.
Yeah, sure.
Himid.
Yeah.
First of all, you relate to some of these aspects of revolution and violence in her work, the theme and the historical background to her, and the way she juxtaposes history. Coming from Zanzibar, I could see why she would be doing that. And I noticed upstairs that she actually left Zanzibar very, very young.
Yeah.
So she would have seen Zanzibar to begin with through the lens of her parents and
her
the
mother.
Like. Mother.
Her father had died, which is why she and her mother left.
Yes.
So her mother was English and her father was African.
Oh,
and they were in Zanzibar as a family, But then when her father died when she was 4 months old, that's when her mother decided to come back with Lubaina back to London.
May I ask, was that in the 60s during the 50s. Zanzibar Revolution?
50s.
Okay, leading
yeah, she
up
was
to
born
it.
In the 50s.
So prior to that.
Yeah, yeah. Yes. But and Zanzibar was always a sort of, you know, it was always a kind of background sort of interest, I think.
Yes. I was fascinated that there was so much about West African history and the Middle Passage. But yet upstairs there's great deal on Zanzibar and also her emphasis in textiles and the crockery and the like, you know, that also suggestive. Did she go back and forth to Zanzibar as a child?
It was later. It was later when she first went back to Zanzibar. Yeah, but I think it was always, because it was the place of her father and her father's family, it was a sort of, you know, it had that sort of kind of originary site. It was an originary site for her, I think.
So she rediscovered it as an adult.
Yes, yeah.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
We have no more questions. I will take this opportunity to thank Dorothy again for her incredible talk and to ask you to join me in a round of applause for her. And thank you again for coming this evening.
And also just to say, if you want to have a quick look at the images, feel free. One of them is a study for Lancaster's, the Swallow Heart dinner service. But thank you very much.
Thank you.